Good morning, everybody. Welcome here this morning. Welcome to those of you who are on Zoom. Special welcome to Joanne joining us from Ethiopia. We're going to watch a video later during the sermon that is from her. And I believe she's going to share briefly later during sharing time. We are going to start out with a short video from Gerald and Ray, who are currently in Japan, witness workers in Japan. So we will start with that, and then we will move into worship this morning.
I remember hearing about one conference in Canada that would close a church if the membership dropped below 65. In Japan, the situation is very different than in North America. The Tokyo Area Fellowship of Mennonite Churches are a group of five churches, with the largest being about 30 members and the smallest about 5 members. Like the story where the boy offered his 5 loaves and 2 fish when 5,000 people needed to be fed, it seems almost embarrassing. What can be done with so little? In Japan, Christians are a tiny minority. Many people are fearful of religious groups, including Christians. Almost every month, we hear in the news about different religious groups committing fraud. To be Christian in Japan is to be vulnerable. And it's even more vulnerable to be a Christian leader. The Tokyo churches have aging pastors, many who suffer with various sicknesses. And because we are too small to be registered with the government, pastors are not able to receive pension or health insurance, unless they can receive it through work that they have outside the church. To become a church leader in Japan often carries the assumption that he or she will not be rich, but rather closer to poverty. But we sense that God is at work. In God's economy, small things can be significant. There is hope for the future. It's amazing that the churches have faithfully continued in spite of the challenges. Pastor Inamine has led the Minuma Church for almost 40 years. He will soon be turning 83. Although he suffered a stroke a while back, he and his wife continue to lead, even with his limited energy. At the Honancho Church, Mr. and Mrs. Ono have faithfully traveled by public transit the 2 hours each way from their home to the church each week for worship. And they've been doing this for 30 or 40 years now. They have served the church in many ways, through things like teaching peace and leading music. Mr. Ono has spent many years organizing a collection of Anabaptist resources in the library of the Tokyo Anabaptist Center. He is now struggling with cancer and is waiting to enter a nursing care facility. Although the churches are small, we see the Spirit of God at work in the faithfulness of the leaders and the church members, such as the Onos and the Inaminians. Although we just moved to Tokyo in November of last year, we have the privilege of continuing to serve in Tokyo, building on relationships we began when we first served here about 25 years ago. One of the big resources we now have are the connections that have already been made between retired mission workers and people in Japan. The prayers of many people continue. Connection is important for these small congregations. How can we connect?
you're able, I invite you to stand as we join in worship together. To worship this morning comes from Psalm 150. Praise the Lord, praise God in his sanctuary, praise him in his mighty heavens, praise him for his acts of power, praise him for his surpassing greatness, praise him with the sounding of the trumpet, praise him with the harp and the lyre, praise him with timbrel and dancing, praise him with the strings and the pipe. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you that we have the ability to come together this morning and worship you in person, and that we have the ability to join from our homes and from halfway across the world. I pray that as we continue in worship this morning, and as we hear from your word, that we would hear what we each need to hear today. Prepare us for those words. Be with us as we continue to worship, and be with us as we fellowship. We pray this in your name. Amen. Let's continue singing.
shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty. God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
Amen. You may be seated.
The text for today's message we find in the Gospel of John in chapter 6, 1 to 14. Some time after this, Jesus crossed to the far shore of the Sea of Galilee, that is, the Sea of Tiberias, and a great crowd of people followed him because they saw the sign he had performed. By healing the sick. Then Jesus went up on a mountainside and sat down with his disciples. The Jewish Passover festival was near. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for these people all to eat?" He asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. Philip answered him, "It would take more than half a year's wages to bring enough bread for each one to have a bite." Another of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. "Here is a boy with five small barley leaves and two small fish. But how far will they go among so many?" Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." There was plenty of grass in that place, and they sat down. About 5,000 men were there. Jesus then took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted. He did the same with the fish. When they had all enough to eat, he said to his disciples, "Gather the pieces that are left over. Let nothing be wasted." So they gathered them and filled 12 baskets with pieces of the 5 barley loaves left over by those who had eaten. After the people saw the sign Jesus performed, they began to say, "Surely, this is a prophet who is to come into the world."
Good morning, and Exiapihiri Mezgin. That means praise the Lord in Amharic. And if you were with me here today, you would hear that over and over throughout the day. I also want to say happy International Witness Sunday and welcome to Mezarete Christos Seminary in Ethiopia. This is where Werner and I will be serving for the next 3 years as volunteers. Werner will be teaching 6 courses each year, and I will be providing faculty and student support, which means doing things like being on the chapel committee or providing English labs for the students, things like that. So I am here today on location, preaching from the student chapel here at the Mezarete Christos Seminary. This is the place where the students come every day to both eat and to worship God. Next week, all the students will be returning. So the place will be packed, and people will be getting ready for their classes so they can prepare for ministry in the Mezarete Christos Church, which is the Mennonite Church of Ethiopia. It is my pleasure to share some thoughts with you today on the theme given, which is, what is in your hands? This phrase or question comes from Exodus chapter 4, verse 2, when Moses is resisting the call from God to help release the Israelites from slavery. If we go all the way back to chapter 3, we see that God initially calls Moses through a burning bush that never gets consumed. Moses, Moses, God calls out to him from the bush, trying to get his attention. And then he shares with him the concern that the Hebrews are suffering, and God shares his mission to free the Israelites from slavery. And now he wants Moses to help him. But then Moses replies in verse 11, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? God reassures him, you won't be alone. He will personally be with him. But still, this doesn't convince Moses, who asks in verse 13, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. And they ask me, what is his name? Then what shall I tell them? It's sad to me that Moses would ask such a question. He's basically asking, who are you? This shows us that Moses doesn't really know who he is, because he asked, who am I? And he doesn't know whose he is. After so long in Israel, so long in exile, God's people are no longer really know who God is. They are slaves to a different master. I wonder if this is also happening in Canada. God patiently replies in verse 14 and 15, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. The Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name you shall call me from generation to generation. And then in chapter 4, verse 1, Moses asks, but what if they don't believe me or listen to me? And they ask, the Lord did not appear to you. Now, God chooses not to answer Moses' question directly, but instead he asks him the question, well, what is in your hand? Now, one of the exegetical keys to understanding a passage is paying special attention when God asks a question. What is he really asking? He already knows the answer, so why? Why is he asking this question? God is often asking questions throughout the whole Bible. He asks Adam, where are you? Even though he knows he's in the garden. Or when he asks the blind man, what do you want me to do for you? Hello, he wants to see. Or when he asks the disciples, who do people say that I am? And who do you say that I am? In all of these situations, including the one where Moses is called, God takes the initiative. He wants to go deeper to help us grow into a greater understanding of who he is. He already knows what is in Moses' hand, but he asks anyway, what is in your hand, Moses? So Moses looks down at his hand, and what does he see? All he sees is a common, ordinary shepherd's staff that he has been using every day for the last 40 years. What use is that? But then God does something surprising. He tells Moses to throw the staff on the ground, and Moses does it. Startled, Moses jumps back as the staff becomes a snake. Multiple commentaries suggest it was a cobra whose venom can kill an elephant. God tells him then, reach out your hand, Moses, and grab it by the tail. Well, that seems risky. I'm not a snake expert, but wouldn't you want to grab the head so you didn't get bitten? Personally, I would be terrified. I can't even go a day without spilling something on my shirt, so I can hardly imagine being able to grab a snake at the exact right place to avoid being poisoned. But Moses follows God's instructions, and it works. The snake returns to its original function as a staff. So why? Why does God ask Moses, what is in your hand? Did he want him to realize that ordinary things can be used by God to do great things? Maybe. It is true that God can use anything to accomplish his will, but was that the main purpose of the question? The miracle happens right after Moses expresses fear that people won't believe that he has been sent by God. This suggests that God wants to increase Moses' faith and trust in him, and to reassure Moses he's not alone in this mission that he's being called to. He would be fully equipped, he would be fully supported for the task through God's power and authority. Often when this passage is preached, the focus is on what is in Moses' hand. And then the application is, well, what is in your hand? This is a common theme throughout the Bible. Story after story talks about how God can take something ordinary or common or small and do something miraculous with it. A seed, a penny, the jawbone of a donkey. In 2 Kings verses 4:1-7, we read about a prophet's wife whose husband has just died, and her two sons are about to become slaves to creditors who she owes money to. She goes to Elisha in tears, and he responds by asking her, "What do you have in your house?" She replies that all she has is a small jar of olive oil. What use is that? He instructs her to collect as many jars as possible from her neighbors and then fill them using the one small jar that she has in her house. To her astonishment, all the jars become full and she's able to sell them to pay off her debt, and she even has extra to live on. This story is repeated again, this kind of theme, in John 6, verses 1-14, when a huge crowd is gathering to listen to Jesus, and he asks Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?" Once again, a question is being asked where the answer was already known. A question asked by the one who declares, just a little bit later in the same chapter, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." And he continues, "But as I told you, you have seen me, and you still do not believe." Sound familiar? Another of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up and said, "Well, here is a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 fish. How far will they go among so many?" And as we know, 5 loaves and 2 fishes in the hands of God fed 5,000 people. And there were even leftovers. Repeatedly, we do see that God can use anything, no matter how ordinary or small, and multiply it by his power. What do you have in your hand? Whether a pen or paper, a hymnal, time, dreams, money, careers, education, a sense of humor, a balloon, a fresh perspective, an analytical mind, or even a staff, God can use anything to glorify his name. Little as much if God is in it. Amen? The first word of encouragement from this passage is that we all have something in our hands, and no matter how ordinary, it can be used when combined with God's power. What is in your hand? This being said, we must remember that without God, Moses would have been unable to do anything. He barely agreed, even after multiple supernatural experiences. Everything was God's initiative. It was God who had compassion on the Israelites, and it was his vision for justice and freedom. God is the one who called Moses. God challenged Moses. God supported Moses in his weakness. The success of the mission depended on God's power. Take God out of the story, and all you have is Moses, continuing to be a shepherd, probably for another 20 years. Last year, the theme for International Witness Sunday was God Calls Us. Jeanette Hansen, director of International Witness, challenged us to reorient our thinking from asking, "What can I do in the world?" to, what is God doing in the world, and how can I be part of it? In his commentary on Exodus, Waldemar Jansen says the purpose of the call is to proclaim God's work in the world through word and life. It can be tempting to focus on what we have in our hands and go to work to achieve our dreams of justice. But if God is not in it, our success will be limited. The truth is, we don't need anything but God. In Canada, Werner and I pastored an intercultural church made up of 40% West Africans. One day I was doing a Bible study with the women's group and mentioned how we can depend on God for our needs, maybe not our wants, but our needs, like food and clothing. One of the African women corrected me. "You're wrong, Joanne. You don't have any needs except Jesus. If we have him, we have enough." And this was a powerful word from someone who had lived through a 14-year civil war and had experienced over and over times where there was nothing in her hands, nothing except God. No food, no home, no money to buy anything that she might want. Interestingly, I've heard multiple Africans preach on this passage, and there's always a focus on God's authority, God's power. In the West, we often focus on what resources we have in our hands to fulfill our plans. But it's not just what we have or don't have in our hand. It is also about God's power, God's call, God's plan. God cares more about the brokenness in the world than we do. Am I right? Moses had a staff in his hand because he was a leader of the sheep. And by God transforming his staff into a snake, he showed Moses that he had power and authority to carry out God's vision, which was to liberate God's people from slavery. Because as God told Moses in chapter 3, verse 7, "I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I've heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering." We don't always think of ourselves as having power and authority, but as God's people, which is who we are, we do. Moses did not think he was able to do what God wanted because he did not understand his identity. He belongs to God. He did not understand who God was, or he wouldn't have been so anxious and unwilling to use what was in his hand. Once Moses identified what was in his hand and surrendered it to God, reality changed. As we read the rest of Exodus, we see that his faith grew, the faith of the Israelites grew, and even the faith of Pharaoh grew. God's power was clear, and even Pharaoh had to surrender to the idea that God is I am, that God is the one who reigns. In the West, we are often uncomfortable with the idea of having authority, maybe because we've seen it misused so many times in the past. But the authority we have to remember, it's not just for us, it is also for the global church. As the global body of Christ, we all must surrender what is in our hands to God. And then we use what he has given us with authority as we work for God's vision of healing and hope in the world. As we celebrate International Witness Sunday, may we ask God what he would like us to do to bring healing and hope to the world, trusting he has given us all something in our hand to use with his power and authority. And may we all have the courage to throw down our staff and grab the snake by the tail, even if it's a cobra. In Jesus' name, amen.
If you're able, I invite you to stand. 2 Corinthians 13. "Finally, brothers and sisters, rejoice. Strive for full restoration. Encourage one another. Be of one mind. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, The love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let's sing.
I speak the name of Jesus over you. In your hurting, in your sorrow, I will ask my God to move. I speak the name 'cause it's all that I can do. In desperation, I'll seek heaven and pray this for you. I pray for your healing, that circumstances would change. I pray that the fear inside would flee in Jesus' name. I pray that a breakthrough would happen today. I pray miracles over your life in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. I speak the name of all authority, declaring blessings, every promise He is faithful to keep. I speak the name no grave could ever hold. He is greater, He is stronger, He's the God of possible. I pray for your healing, that circumstances would change. I pray that the fear inside would flee in Jesus' name. I pray that a breakthrough would happen today. I pray miracles over your life in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Oh, come believe it, come receive it. All the power of His Spirit is now forever yours. Come believe it, come receive it. In the mighty name of Jesus, all things are possible. I pray for your healing, that circumstances would change. I pray that the fear inside would flee in Jesus' name. I pray that a breakthrough would happen today. I pray miracles over your life in Jesus' name. I pray for revival, restoration of faith. I pray that the dead will come alive in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name.
Peace.